Morning, gang. It's Wednesday, the 8th of March, 2017. Welcome along to this morning's United Kingdom Talk. I forgot to do the date again, haven't I? Sorry about that. A little date should come up at the bottom there. But I've got to type it in first and set it up before I start. Because if I click it now, it'd be yesterday's date. And we can't have people being confused. There's enough confusion on this programme as it is now. There really is. Good morning to our early sitters this morning. Kevin's there. Mr. Ray Reynolds, International Ray Reynolds, who's going to appear at Chris Ridden's Quiz Night tonight at the King's Head Theatre Bar. Come and join us along there if you want to, boys and girls. Starts at 8.30 and finishes at 10.30. Okay, that's the Quiz Night this morning. I had to go and get a key cut yesterday. I noticed on Monday, on my way back, when I got back from work, I've got a gate at the front of my door. So there's a gate and then a front door. And it's got two locks, one at the top, one at the bottom. And they're different locks, so you need different keys. And the bottom one I noticed it recently, it's been getting a bit, jiggly. So you've got to put the key in and it sort of won't come out. And Monday I had a real job getting in there, but I managed to open the gate eventually after a few tries. Oh, hang on, let me just write something down there. Thank you. Right. After a few tries, I managed to get in and I looked at the key and where it's cut, a lot of it had worn away. You know, it's like, it's a soft metal, to be honest. Like, I think it's a brass or something like that. And it had worn. So if you got your teeth like that, it kind of worn around there. So yesterday I went out to get a new key cut. Ron, my mate's got a spare one from my house, so I took his one, took it into the key cutting places, Timpson's. Does anyone else cut keys anymore? It's only Timpson's that I can find, and only since we're Timpson's. Anyway, they're very nice in there. I had to go in there twice because the bloke wasn't there. There was a bloke that I wouldn't say was a boy. No, there was a bloke there about 28. And whoever was going in there for stuff, he kept saying, oh, well, the bloke's gone away for 10 minutes. He'll be back in 10 minutes if you want to come back, or you can leave your key here. So I left the key there. And then there was another woman wanted something else, and another bloke wanted something else in front of me. And he was saying the same to all of them, so I didn't quite see the point of him being there. Other than to polish up the counters, perhaps, or count the money. But I don't know what he was doing. So I went away from there, popped into Boots the chemist for something, and then I came back again, and by then the bloke was there, and I gave him the key. And he puts it on some machine. I think the machine, I mean, you can't see how it works, can you? But I think he puts the key on the machine, and it just follows round exactly on the key that you've given them. So I thought to myself, I better not give him the worn-out key because that's not going to fall around exactly, is it? So I gave him Ronnie's key and that seems to be all functioning within normal parameters now. As Carl keeps correcting me, normal parameters, isn't it? Yes. And then I rung up the doctor because, you know, I need a spacer for my asthma inhaler because it's damaging the back of my throat, the brown one, that is. So I need a spacer for that. So I rang up the doctor and she says, well, there's about 200 different ones. Do you remember when you had it? I said, well, it's at least a minimum of 10 years ago that I had this thing. And I remember, I mean, I didn't tell her, but I remember chucking it away years ago because I just wasn't using the thing. But the brown inhaler is damaging the back of my throat. I'm getting big red patches come up sort of at the back roof of my mouth and they're incredibly itchy. So you're supposed to use this spacer. Of course, a lot of people don't bother. You don't bother until there's damage done, do you really? Really, you should do exactly what the doctor tells you. Yes, you should. So I've got to put this spacer in the middle like that. So I rang up the doctor and the prescription nurse, I think she is. And she was saying there's about 200 different types. So she's looking through my bag. She said, I can't find it at all here. I said, well, you'd have to go back at least 10 years. She said, I'll get Dorothy, the prescription manager, to give you a ring. I think it was something like that. Anyway, I said, what time would that be? It would be sometime this afternoon. Well, of course, you know. So the whole of the afternoon, the phone was on. About 5 o'clock, I wanted to have a little sleep, so I went to bed at 5 o'clock, got up again at 7, and of course she'd rung in that time, you know, so we haven't got any closer to that, really. What I might do is take my little asthma brown thing in this morning when I walk up to the swimming pool and show it to the prescription nurse there. But apparently there's loads and loads of different types of these things, which I didn't know, and we can't have my little throat being damaged. I mean, can you imagine? You know, if my throat is damaged that badly, I might not be able to talk to you again. How awful would that be? God's sake. Morning to Rod Brown, who's with us. Liam Colligan is there as well. And Kevin Webster. I think I've said hello to Kevin already, haven't I? Did I say hello to you, Kevin? I hope I did. Sorry if I didn't. I'm a mind all over the place this morning, okay? Mind all over the place. So that's new key and spaces I've done. So I got up last night again about 7 o'clock, had some dinner. What did I have? Jacket potato with beans and cheese on toast. Yes, but not on toast. No, no bread for Lent. I had beans and cheese on jacket potato. Yes. And then I went up to Ronnie's house and I took with me a packet of butterscotch Angel Delight. Oh, that's what I remember. Joanna was saying the other day, you said you'd given up sweets for Lent. Isn't Angel Delight sweets? No. No, it's not. Angel Delight is a pudding, sometimes known as a sweet, but it's not sweets. Sweets, certainly, it might be different in America. Sweets in this country are little wrapped things, perhaps a bar of chocolate that would be classed as sweets, packet of round trees, packet of polos, bag of toffees, chocolate eclairs. Oh, nom, 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 nom. No, not the long ones from the bakery. Cadbury's chocolate eclairs. How nice are those? Oh, bits of soft toffee with that powdered chocolate in the middle. Absolutely beautiful. Very good for removing fillings. If you've got a loose filling, get yourself a bag of Cadbury's chocolate eclairs and it will drag them out of your head. And then you'll take the toffee out and it'll be covered in loose fillings. Very, very good for removing fillings. So they're classed as sweets. Puddings, you could say, what's for sweet, okay? Or what's for pudding. But it's not kind of sweet. So that's the difference there, my darling, all right? So I went up to Ronnie. Ronnie's with a packet of butterscotch Angel Delight. He said, take my keys with you so I don't have to get up. Honestly, it's so lazy sometimes. It really is. I walked up there, which is about a 20, 25-minute walk, and got in and we watched some television. We watched an episode of Victoria. I know it was on last year. I've only seen the first two episodes so far. Was it the first three? I think it's the first two, possibly. I've only seen the first two episodes now. So I've got loads to catch up on that. That's about Queen Victoria, you know, when she was a young girl and all that. And it was on last year on ITV, so I enjoyed that. And then he'd recorded for me this programme, Motorway Crashes, Police Motorway, something like that. There's a lot of these programmes on at the moment, which I quite enjoy, I must admit. You know, and this particular one is about the M25. The country's biggest motorway. It's always getting jammed up and you're getting stuck on there for hours on end. And it shows you different crashes, people doing stupid things on the motorway. And it was about the motorway police. Now, what are they called now? Traffic officers. It was about traffic officers. And he said, look at this. Anyway, so I'm watching it and then my neighbour appeared. Two doors down. Tim! Tim, my neighbour. Now, he is a traffic officer. And I often have little conversations with him about car driving and all that. Because you see some horrendous car driving. You really do. In particular at night. Now, you know, and I have no reason to lie to you, I'm a bit of a slow economic driver now. On the motorway, I'm on the inside lane, around about 55 mile an hour. That does me. Doesn't bother me. When you're driving at a reasonable speed like that, I have to tell you, you can see the amount of idiots that actually go past you all the time at trans warp speed is just ridiculous. And you see them all cutting each other up, overtaking suddenly like that, one side to the other, going along there. And the worst thing is that they go through motorway lanes that they are closed. Because on the gantry above, if you get a red X, it means it's closed. It doesn't mean move over to the other lane when you see something ahead. It means get out of the lane now. You're not supposed, if it's got an X, you're not supposed to go underneath it. It means it's closed. And the amount of cars I see, and they carry on in those X's, you know, just to save about 3 minutes, or, you know, 3 seconds more like, so that they don't have to go in the slower moving traffic. Because, of course, you know, if you've got like two lanes closed, there's only three on the motorway generally, sometimes four or five, but most of the time three. If you've got two closed and everything's been shunted over to one of the other lanes, then, of course, it's going to move a bit closer, isn't it? And the reason is, you know, people are being more careful as they go across. So these idiots that don't want to go slow, they continue going in the other lane. And it's ridiculous. You must not go. As soon as you see that X, you've got to get... I mean, the one before would have told you to move over anyway. But they all ignore that one. And if there's an X, you must not go in it. And it showed people on there last night going through these X's. And there was one articulated lorry where all three lanes were closed. Okay, all three of these lanes were closed. So... And the police are doing something, and this idiot lorry driver has gone on the hard shoulder, you know, the lane on the left, to get past. And this policeman putting out cones there, and he got so close to being knocked over by this articulated lorry. Well, I hope they got his number and stopped him. I mean, people are just so stupid. Anyway, so we're watching this. And then lo and behold, my neighbour two doors down appeared. Tim! Doing a little bit of chat and assisting people with problems on the motorway, because they don't, you know, these traffic officers, they don't nick people. They are there to help people, assist the police and all this business. A very, very important job. And of course, you get all these other idiots, you know, oh, you're not really police and all this business. They do. No, they're not really police, but they're still doing a bloody important job. I tell you that now. You always get someone running people down, don't you, all the time. So I was very, very pleased to see Television Tim. He will now be known as I bet his wife and son are very proud of him. That was great, that was, actually. It was really great. Television Tim is now part of the Motorway television programme. We love it. I absolutely love it. So that was my night last night. And then it got to walking home. I always like to walk to and from my mate's house. You know, part of the whole exercise thing. So I walked back, and I think I came straight up here to bed. Watched a tight about 5 minutes of Holby City, and then I came to bed. So that was my night yesterday. Ray Reynolds says, hi there, pop pickers. Yes, it's me again. Ray Reynolds used to be a DJ, you know. He did. Hello, David Jackson. Yes, I've changed my room. I've changed the room about a little bit, David. I've got another bit of cloth coming for over there. I've had to zoom in slightly because I ran out of cloth. You know, I try not to buy any more than is absolutely necessary. And that goes with gas as well. The poor cat. The cat likes the radiator on 24 hours a day. She does. And she literally sits on a little stool near the radiator. And if it's not on, she starts meowing, meow, meow, and sits there looking at the radiator, demanding that it be switched on. But as it's warmed up slightly the last couple of days, so I'm not having the heating on so much. We have to save the bills. But yes, you're quite right, David. I've changed the background a bit. It's a little bit more plain now, isn't it? Good morning to my sister, Sharon Butler, who's looking for a cleaning job at the moment, actually. If you're up in Lincolnshire near Woodhall Spa, if you have a little cleaning job for my sister, she is looking for work at the moment. Now, my sister does, I think you would call it elderly care. So if you're an old person and you need someone to do the shopping, the cleaning and all that business, that is what my sister does. But unfortunately, one of her dear old people passed away last week. So that's sad enough in itself. There's something floating around in the room. What is that? It could be a Russian spy. Russians are spying on you at the moment. Yes. So she's looking for a little cleaning job. She goes around and does all that business. One of her people, one of her little dear old men died. I think it was a lady or a man. Well, I think it was a man. Was it a man? Can't remember. But one of them passed away last week. So she's down a job now. So she needs a little bit of work. Yes, we got a shower. My sister says, if I moved up there, I could look after you. I need someone to look after me, sis. I absolutely do. I do need someone to look after me, sis. All right. There's a phone line open if you want to join in this morning. 020-8144-3477 is my phone number, okay? 020-8144-3477. It's a local London number, not a premium rate number. It's up there. You don't have to ring in. If you're quite happy to just sit there and watch and listen, that's okay as well. 020-8144-3477. Now, talking about people dying and all that, I came across this story this morning in the Daily Mail, which... It is kind of a serious story, so I don't want to make light of that, okay? But harrowing footage of a dead teenager having his hair cut was posted on Facebook. Now, this boy, 15, died last month after his moped collided with a lamppost in Wigan in Manchester. His name was Cameron. And, you know, when I see young people on mopeds, I mean, my heart goes. It really did. My nephew, Jimmy, he used to have a moped. And he was going round a corner one day and hit something on the road and ended up, you know, over, so to speak. It's not so much, you know, because mopeds, I think the maximum speed is about 40 mile an hour, is it? Or 50? Something like that. And probably, you know, boys being boys, they will be going at 50. It's not necessarily the coming off the motorbike that kills them. It's the coming off the motorbike and another vehicle coming the other way. And my nephew was extremely lucky, as many people are, you know, boys and girls. When they're driving along, they come off the motorbike and there just happens to be nothing coming the other way, which was the case with my nephew. But he ended up on the road, you know, and it's frightening. Not so the case with this poor lad. You know, it frightens the life of me seeing anyone on motorbikes. You can be the best motorcyclist or moped rider, I suppose. I don't know what they're called. Moped riders in the world. But you can't train the idiot who's driving the car on the other side. I just told you about the motorway traffic that I see sometimes on the way home. Anyway, his grief-stricken parents had asked a local barber to cut Cameron's hair ahead of his funeral. Because, you know, when you die, things keep growing. Yes, not my hair. That's not going to grow. Even when I'm dead, I will still have that bald patch, I'm sure. I mean, actually, I could talk to my sister now. You know, if I go first, sis, do you think I should have a wig on in the coffin? Would that work? Does that work for you? Or just cut some of your cat's fur off and put that on my head. Anyway, his grief-stricken parents had asked a local barber to cut Cameron's hair ahead of his funeral, but were left devastated when a video of the boy in his coffin was put online. I mean, that's a bit much, isn't it? Don't you think that's a bit much? As a hairdresser from the shop carried out the cut, his friend filmed it as Cameron lay in his coffin and later posted it on Facebook. And it's just awful. One outraged friend responded to the video. I cannot believe my friend trusted you to cut her precious son's hair before she laid him to rest. And you took a video. Disgusting. Well, I must admit, you know, if that had been a child of mine, I think I would have been there. I think I would have actually been there to see that being done, wouldn't you? Because, you know, mums and parents and things like that, they want to see their children having their hair cut and that sort of thing. Hello to Vectis on the Isle of Wight calling in. Good morning, sir.
I'm disgusted at you.
I know. You saw it as well, did you?
No. I'm just words fail me. I'm just very disappointed with you, Chris.
With me?
Yeah, with you.
What have I done?
You're one of those flipping idiots that are trying to hammer down the motorway at God knows what mile an hour that I have to swerve to avoid because you're doing bloody 5 mile an hour. What's the matter with you, man?
You're talking about the story before the one I'm talking about.
I am, yes. I'm not talking about I did catch that as I phoned up and seen but you know, this is a lot more of a frivolous story, I know, but for heaven's sake, man, you know what that your right foot for in a car?
Yes, it goes down as far as 55 mile an hour. That's fast enough in the inside lane.
God, I'm allowed to do 56 in my lorry.
You haven't got a white van, have you, by any chance?
I've got a white truck. I don't drive on my own van, but...
Is it one of those awful white Sprinter vans? I do hate those with passion. I really do. Even the post office have got those now. The Sprinter vans. We saw one yesterday.
But what do you hate more, a Sprinter van or a white Prius?
Mind you, on that little island of yours, you know, you can't get to more than 30 mile an hour before you reach the end, can you?
Well, funny enough, I'm at work now. I'm in the lorry of a colleague, and all the windows are steamed up, so I can't see much.
Right.
But we won't get into that. I didn't smile anyway.
But
later on, I'm actually going to go along a road that's on the island that's called the Military Road. That rumour has it, I don't know whether it's local folklore, but it was actually built by the Romans. Because I'm called Vectis Humpty, and that's what the Romans called the Isle of Wight. Not Vectis Humpty, but Vectis.
What motorway do you have on the Isle of Wight, then?
Well, we don't. We have this road that's called the Military Road, which is just a bay road, so
right.
Two-way road, but it's very straight.
Oh, okay, yes. You're not really big enough. I mean, you're really not really big enough to have a motorway. You'll be putting your foot down, you get to 40, and then suddenly you find you're at the end.
Well, funny enough, in Newport, just where our main council offices are, there's a dual carriageway. That's a motorway spec dual carriageway, believe it or not, but it's about three-quarters of a mile long.
Now, that's better. Are you on an iPhone 7?
iPhone 5.
God, well, keep it in front of your mouth, will you?
I'm sorry, my mouth's very small, so I have trouble keeping it in front of me.
I don't think that's the case. I've seen your radio programme.
So we have got a motorway, but as you say, you're literally right in what you're saying. If I can't use sort of... you've dreamt of getting to 70 miles an hour, there's a roundabout at the end, you've got to stop. That's what you get for living on the dear old Italy widget.
How inconvenient. I bet there's not many people on there with a Lamborghini.
No, it suits you, the way you crawl about in first gear, but not a tight, tight me.
Yeah, yeah. Do you need to come out of first gear at all when you're driving around that little place of yours?
Sometimes, you're really brave. If you want to overtake someone in a Prius that's just on the back seat, you
know. Oh, surely you don't have those on the island. No, you don't allow those on their Priuses, do you? Uber drivers with their Priuses.
I've seen a few Nissan Leafs, but I haven't seen a Prius for a while. We don't have Uber over here. They don't operate.
Well, do you have minicabs?
Yeah, sort of, you have licensed cabs and private hire, but what's your problem with Uber anyway? I use that in London. I think they're very efficient.
Oh, come on, I've said it to you so many times. I've told you so many times. They clog up the roads. They clog up that Euston Road. They've no idea where they're going. And there's hundreds of them. There's hundreds of them now on the Euston Road, and they can't drive. They can't drive.
I don't think there's anything wrong with the initial idea. The trouble is now, I think it's come to light that whatever you think of them, I don't know, they've given quite a bad deal by the company, haven't they? They're always in the news now, aren't they, about drivers taking them to port and
working
for less than the wage. And
there's more and more people now moaning about them. There is. I mean, they gave out hundreds and hundreds of licences over the last couple of years to Uber drivers, and they can't drive. A lot of them can't speak English. I mean, what's all that about? How can you get into a cab in England and they can't speak English? You know, would you expect to get into a cab in France and then not be able to speak French? You wouldn't expect it, would you? Well, how can that be happening? It's just ridiculous. Absolutely ridiculous.
A lot of people come over to the Isle of Wight and can't talk Isle of Wight. We have trouble with that. Nipper.
They do what?
I said a lot of people come over to the Isle of Wight and they can't talk Isle of Wight. We talk a special language over here.
What language do you talk then?
We talk Isley Widget.
Isley Widget language. Where's the lovely Shania today? Is she at work somewhere?
Yes. I said she's beaming away at her admin job at her primary school. I expect Callum might well be listening to you, actually.
Oh, is Callum with us this morning?
Well, he might.
He'd be able to hear what bad quality that telephone is this morning. You wait till you listen back to the recording.
I'm not in a phenomenal, probably very good area. Trouble is with the island; it's very hilly. I'm in a place at the moment in the lorry called Whitwell.
No. It's nothing to do with the phone signal. It's the way you're holding it this morning.
There's nothing wrong with my iPhone.
There is. No, there's nothing wrong with your iPhone. It's the way you're holding it. You'll hear it later, fading in and out. You are.
Oh, hello.
Never mind.
Hello?
Hello?
Are you still there?
Yes, of course I'm still here. You haven't put the phone down yet.
No, my phone made a funny noise as if it hadn't cut out.
It's all very strange and mysterious.
Anyway, I'll let you go because I've just got to set off down the road and pick up people's dirty, smelly rubbish and put it in the back of my lorry.
Well, say hello to those lovely people for me. And don't forget to go through the bags just in case anyone's mixed up their recycling. We're not having any of that, dear.
Oh, no. No, I'll find people for that. I'll write it down in my little book and they get a big fine.
Good.
Having that.
Good.
Got to be done right.
See you later, Vectis. Thank you.
See ya.
Bye. Au revoir. Bye-bye now. Vectis calling in there from the Isle of Wight, boys and girls, just talking about the motorway driving. You've got to drive slow, haven't you? Got to drive slow. Just going back to that story then, boys and girls, about that boy. So they actually videoed. This poor boy is dead. And the hairdresser videoed, just to recap, they videoed taking, cutting the poor little boy's hair, presumably before he was buried or, you know, sent up in smoke or something like that. Isn't that awful? I think that's an awful story. You know, you might want to do it for yourself. Now, it comes onto another story. And I wonder what you think about this. I've often wondered why it is we have weddings. We have weddings. We have christenings. First Holy Communions, that sort of thing, right? But why is it no one ever takes photographs of funerals? I personally don't have a bit of a problem with that. Do you think it's disrespectful? I mean, I would happily have at my own funeral hundreds of photos. Well, I think I should arrange it really now. Photos, videos. We'll open the coffin so you can get a few last pictures of me before I start to decompose. I don't really have a problem with people taking photos at funerals. And I've been to a few funerals before. And I thought of going up to the person whose funeral it is and saying, you know, would you like me to take some food photographs of the people there and the flowers and that? No one ever does, but I never have done it. I never have done it, except on one occasion where it was my brother-in-law's mother's funeral. And I did take a couple of photos there, which I didn't put them online. I only sent to him just in case he wanted them. But everyone seems a little bit too scared to take out a camera at a funeral. What do you think of that? Is it disrespectful? But is it disrespectful if the person who's gone wanted that to happen anyway? I'd love to know your thoughts on that. 020-8144-3477 is my phone number, right? 020-8144-3477. Do you think people should take photos, videos, sound recordings at funerals? Isn't it a lovely thing? Sometimes some of them are very big occasions with choirs and things like that, all singing hymns and that. And wouldn't it be nice to have that memory of one of your loved ones before they go on to wherever we all go on to? 020-8144-3477. What about your own funeral? Is it planned? Have you done it yet? Have you planned that? I bet you haven't. I haven't. I don't think anyone does, do they? But if you were, would you put in there, please take as many photographs or videos as you want, or sound recordings? 020-8144-3477 with your thoughts on that. Let's just go back a little bit. There we are. My sister says there's a nice house in Kirby-on-Bane. Is there? Or could you send me the link to that? Let's have a look. Isn't that a flood area, Kirby-on-Bane, Sharon? I'm sure that's a flood area. Is that the one I saw? Because I don't want to ever be near water. I remember my sister, they had a lot of floods up in Lincolnshire a couple of years back. Fortunately, not in my sister's house, but certainly the whole area. Oh, it must be awful to have a flood. Because as I said before, it's not clean water. It's not even just water from the river. It's the sewage. You've got a house full of sewage. How awful. Dreadful, dreadful, dreadful. Good morning to Colin, who's with us this morning. Hope you're getting better there, Colin. I know you haven't been too well, my friend. All right. My sister also says, don't talk about your dying. It upsets me. Well, we've got to talk about these things, sis. You know, hopefully it won't be for another 200, 300, 400 years. 5, 6, 7. I might be here for another 1,000 years. Till the year 3000. I wonder what it'll be like in the year 3000. Will we finally have flying cars? Or will the M25 then be 10 lanes across and it will still be chock-a-block with traffic, I reckon. Mainly because people like me in these slow lanes doing 55 mile an hour, which is upsetting Vectis. Thank you. Oh, dear. Good morning to Josh. Hello, Josh, who says, I haven't planned my funeral yet, but if I did, I wouldn't have a problem with people taking photos. No, neither would I. I don't know what the problem is. Sometimes you do see people taking photographs of the flowers outside, but you never, ever see them in the church or chapel or whatever you go to in there, do you? You know, put a little message on there if you don't want to call in and we'll do that, all right? Now, bad news, boys and girls, we are all being spied upon, as you well know. Now, maybe you're like me and you don't mind being in front of a little camera for a period of time each day. I love it. I love coming here and having a little bit of a chat to you. I do. But what I object to is being filmed when I don't want to be filmed. For example, in the car, walking around town. I hate these cameras all over the place. People would say, ah, yeah, but if you're not doing anything wrong, what have you got to worry about? Well, nothing. But the point is, I don't want to be filmed all the time. That's my choice, isn't it? Don't want to be filmed. Well, look at this. The publication of WikiLeaks of documents, it says, are from the CIA's secret hacking program. Describe tools that can turn a world of increasingly networked camera and microphone-equipped devices into eavesdroppers. And you'd be surprised. Smart televisions and cars now have onboard computers and microphones, joining the ubiquitous smartphones, laptops and tablets that have microphones and cameras as standard for a decade. You don't really think about this, do you? Maybe you've got one of those televisions with a camera in it. My niece has. My niece has a television. She's got a Samsung telly, has a little camera at the top, and I think she can do Skype and that sort of thing. Although she's had now... It's hopeless. She's had 3 Skype accounts now and can never remember the Skype password. I even bought her an extra camera to plug into the back of it so that I could have Skype conversations with her and her children. Can't remember the password. Useless. Useless. Not only that, but your mobile phone, that's all got a little microphone and a camera. You don't know. How do you know someone's not switched that on and is watching you at this very moment? It is different to me sitting here. I have chosen to turn on that camera and turn on this microphone and speak to you. I've chosen to do that. But I haven't chosen someone to look at me through the smartphone, have I? It goes on. How worried should consumers be to have these surrounded themselves with these devices? It's in this morning's Daily Mail. Importantly, the intrusion tools highlighted by the leak do not appear to be instruments of mass surveillance. But it could be, couldn't it? Perhaps a government department could decide tomorrow, OK, let's have a look at him. What's his number? OK, pushes a few buttons and bang, there I am on the telly. Or on their telly in government headquarters. Theresa May could be watching this programme at this very moment. I'd love to have a cup of tea with Theresa, I would. It's not as if everyone's TV or high-tech vehicle is at risk. It's unsurprising and also somewhat reassuring that these tools that appear to be targeted at specific people's devices by compromising the software on them are as opposed to tools that decrypt the encrypted traffic over the internet. There's a lot of long words here, aren't there? So it's all very worrying, I think. How is a TV hacked? Well, WikiLeaks said it identified a project known as Weeping Angel. Where US and British intelligence agencies developed a way to take over Samsung smart TVs, equipped with microphones, forcing them to record conversations when the device appeared to be turned off. So it's not even on. The blooming telly's off and they can record with it. Experts have said that smart TVs and other internet-connected devices can be exploited to monitor a target. So that's only one thing, you see. That's just one thing. That's just TVs. But there's hundreds and hundreds of things that they can listen and watch us. Would they want to watch me listen? Would they want to watch me or listen to me doing stuff that I do? Very unlikely. I can't think of anything that they want to watch me doing or speaking about. On the other hand, if government people can do it, what about people like advertisers? Oh, hang on a minute. He's talking about smartphones. Let's send him 10 million adverts now about the latest smartphone gadgets. I mean, it's bad enough on Amazon now, isn't it? When you look at stuff, have you noticed when you look at something on Amazon, the next weeks, that thing keeps popping up in some of your pages, either on your Facebook page or something like that. It is most disturbing. Most disturbing. There we are. So worry carefully about your cameras and microphones on everything. Yes. If you've got one of those little cameras on the telly at home, put a bit of tape over it or something like that so no one can watch you. All right? Let's do some messages from the last couple of shows because we haven't been doing these messages. Hello to Simon. We were talking about holiday camps and working at Pontins, possibly. Simon says, Pontins and Butlins are awesome. But when I worked at Butlins in Bognor, there was a red coat called Vanessa from Luton. My God, she was talentless and no personality. In fact, she had the personality of a garden allotment. Have you got one of those, Simon? I had an allotment years and years ago. Oh, it was a blooming pain. It really was. You'd have to load up. The trouble is, it took so long to do it. You'd load up your car with your spade and all that. You'd take the journey down there, unload it all again. And these allotments are big. You know, don't look at your car. I have a small allotment. No, they are very, very big allotments. Never again. Let's have a look there. Alan says he loves the new background. Thank you very much, Alan. Graham says, I've had the camera, because we're talking about camera down the throat, which I don't need now. But Graham says, I've had the camera down the throat twice over time. I've seen people coming back after taking the knockout drug and in an awful state from the drug. Plus, if you are knocked out normally, you have to have someone there to take you home. Whereas if you can stay awake, you just leave and it's all done. I found it okay. It's just mind over matter and you can do it. Camera is not in there for long. They do spray your throat to help relaxation, and nurses are very good alongside. However, I'm now a little concerned you mentioned the camera in the back passage. I hope they clean it each time. Dear. Oh, that's awful. You will be fine, Chris. Be brave and stay awake. So I didn't have to have that in the end, Graham. Thank God for that. I really didn't want that to happen anyway. Joanna says, hope you had a good experience on the train. Yes. A brush against or maybe someone grab your bum. Hope it all goes well. No, none of those things happened, unfortunately, Joanna. The train wasn't as busy as I thought it would be, as you saw on yesterday's show. she says, wow, the expense for the train, it really did cost a lot of money. £26.50 just for one trip in and out of London. Also, didn't you, said this before at the beginning of the show, did you not give up sweets for Lent? Doesn't that include Angel Delight? No, we don't. Angel Delight wouldn't be included as sweets. It might be included as a sweet, but I didn't give up puddings for Lent. Not that I have them anyway. Rarely do I have pudding, although I had some nice Angel Delight yesterday. Joanna also says, on the subject of your stomach, it could be the sweet corn, which is creating gas. Very hard for the stomach to digest. Takes quite a long time to break down. Sometimes it doesn't and comes out whole. God, how are we getting to talk on all this? When you mentioned football, are you talking about soccer? Yes, Joanna, yes, soccer is football. Okay. All right, boys and girls, let's do today's birthdays and then we're going home. Or we're going out, actually, off to the swimming pool later on. Happy birthday to Stephen Sharp. DJ extraordinaire. Happy birthday, Stephen. Hope you have a lovely day. It's 8 years since I saw you. Happy birthday, Stephen. Gary Owen. It's Gary Owen's birthday today. Johnboy McCormack, who was one of Heaven's best bar staff, weren't you? He worked with me at Heaven. I was the DJ. He was the barman. I think he's on the planes now on British Airways. So happy birthday, John. Peter William Wank. Oh, I nearly got the name wrong. Peter William Walker. Happy birthday to you. Tim, oh, look at Tim Jarmaine Groves. Little Tim, Another person who I haven't seen for ages. Happy birthday, Tim. David Horton, it's his birthday today. And Pete Ferrell, who I think lives in New York. He used to come to my karaoke nights that were in Camden Town, at Blues's in Camden Town when I was there. So happy birthday to you all, boys and girls. Here comes the song. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday. Happy birthday. Happy birthday to you. All right. Enjoy your birthday today, boys and girls. That's it for the show today. Being a Wednesday, I shall be hosting a quiz night tonight, each and every Wednesday. That's happening at the King's Head Theatre Bar in Upper Street, Islington, starting at 8:30 and finishing at 10:30. Right, so that's the quiz tonight, each and every Wednesday, at the King's Head Theatre Bar in Upper Street, Islington, 8:30 to 10:30. Have a nice Wednesday. I'm off to the swimming pool now. Thanks for watching and listening. Cheerio now.